there's a commonality, whereas we all want safer neighborhoods. We all want better schools for our kids. Those are the common denominators that bind us. And it's, we have to stop thinking that we're in each other's way.
Diversity in the 603, new avenues for communication and understanding, next on The State We're In. Hello, welcome to The State We're In. I'm Melanie Plenda. New census data shows New Hampshire is growing more diverse, though is not as diverse as the rest of the country. That said, there are more than 96,000 people living in the Granite State who identify as something other than white. These people represent many cultures and ethnicities and are making significant contributions to all sectors of our society. And now, there's a new publication designed to share the stories of entrepreneurs, artists, changemakers, and thinkers. It's called 603 Diversity. Joining me now to talk about the launch of the new publication is Ernesto Burden, publisher of McLean Communications. Ernesto, thanks so much for joining us.
Thank you for having me. It's a pleasure to be here.
So let's start with a definition. What do you mean by diversity?
That is a great question. And a challenging one, because it was one of the big challenges of creating a magazine about diversity is to identify what it is in a narrow enough way so as to be able to provide a meaningful sort of niche for the magazine to exist in, but in a broad enough way to accurately represent what diversity is. That sounds like a bunch of jargon, but the truth is that when you think about diversity, I think the first thing that comes to mind for people would be ethnic or racial diversity. And we didn't certainly want to limit it to that. Our James McKim, who was one of our columnists in the first issue, wrote compellingly about diversity, and he does a lot of consulting and coaching on diversity issues. And he really identifies diversity very broadly, you know, from age and gender, religious background, really all of the different things that might make up the human experience. All of those lead to this understanding of diversity is like almost all encompassing, right? And so that led us to, a real challenge when you're thinking about how do we reflect diversity in a magazine, when in some ways the spectrum of diversity is so broad. And the answer that we came to was first that we would just do our best with it. That's been one of the watchwords of the magazine as we've developed it is, we know we're not going to be perfect. So perfect is the enemy of good. We're just going to keep going and let our readers and our contributors educate us as we go along. But the other thing that we realized is, from a practical perspective, like what's the point of doing a magazine about diversity? It's that the more that people know about who their neighbors are, the less their opinions of their neighbors are shaped by some kind of social media or political echo chamber, and the more they can be shaped by their genuine knowledge of empathy for and eventually affection towards those neighbors. And so from the practical perspective of the magazine, we think diversity, at least as we'll showcase it going out of the gate, is what's not being represented right now well everywhere else. How do we introduce people to the stories that they're not hearing?
Sure. And talk to us a little bit about some of the contributors you have writing for 603 Diversity. Why was it important to have a diverse group of journalists telling these stories?
Well, for a couple of reasons. One, they're their stories. And we certainly had conversations right at the beginning. As we're thinking about, again, the purpose of the magazine, what's it to do? What is it, should it be doing? It's making those introductions to diverse communities throughout our state and the contributions that they're making to the culture of the state. But it's also providing representation for those communities. And I think that representation for the writers, the artists, the photographers, all of the contributors is really important as well. And I know having been in the media environment in this state for, gosh, 20 years almost, I think. In a management role, I didn't get a lot of resumes to the newspapers that I worked at from diverse candidates. And that led to, and I think this is a question that employers across the state wrestle with, even when they want to do diversity well, is like, well, what if we don't get applications? How do we have a diverse workforce? And the answer, I think, is you have to go looking for people. Yep. And so we went looking for contributors, and we found some amazing people who not only had great things to say in the magazine, but were just great people for us to have met to begin with. And also, of course, in addition to contributors, we also spent a lot of time talking to other people who both work in diversity and are just members of diverse communities in the state.
Switching a little bit to sort of the publishing side of this, this is a quarterly publication. So what are some of the challenges in distribution?
Well, in distribution specifically, we actually, rather than have challenges, we have some really great advantages in distribution, which are, you know, we have New Hampshire Business Review, which is the state's business, statewide business newspaper that is delivered to a subscriber base. And we have New Hampshire Magazine, which is a statewide regional magazine. That's delivered also to a subscriber base. So we're able to insert the diversity magazine into one issue of New Hampshire Magazine per quarter and one issue of New Hampshire Business Review per quarter and really get broad distribution. And in addition to that, we're also sending it out to major chambers of commerce in the state that are also distributing it for us. And we're making it available for free to businesses in diverse communities to distribute from their businesses.
That's great. You mentioned in the publisher's note of the first issue that you grew up in southern Vermont in a small town where nobody looked like you. How did that affect you?
I think, you know, for years, I don't even think I thought too much about it other than, gosh, how to describe it. So I had a great childhood. I don't want to, criticize the overall experience of my childhood. It was great. But it was very strange. So I grew up in a household where I grew up with my mother and adoptive father. And, I didn't know my biological father. He was from Peru. And we had not... I didn't have anybody in the household who looked like me, and I didn't, and there wasn't anybody back then, even on TV, other than Eric Estrada, who looked much like me. And it really was, it was something that, that other people noticed, other people talked about. It was, kids are tough on each other anyway. And so it was something that, that was a part of just day-to-day life, almost the background noise of day-to-day life. There was no getting away from it. It also, I think there was some impact, and not to get too personal, but there was some impact on how I saw myself, how I perceived how I looked compared to other people, and there was maybe a sense of not right or not, not belonging. And I guess to draw that directly to what we're doing now, that's what many people who I talked to as we were launching this project said that they appreciated about it was the opportunity for representation, to be able to see people who look like them. And I remember how valuable that felt to me as sort of the Hollywood movie media environment began to shift in the, later 70s or into the 80s and into the 90s. And I think it's not very hard now to find people of Hispanic background, in film as leads and things like that. But back in the day, it was quite a different story.
And it's really interesting, too, because you had talked previously sort of the impact that the magazine, might have on the way people see their neighbors. But this is a really interesting idea of how how people of color in our state will see themselves. So what, in that sense, what do you hope? I mean, what do you hope they get from this publication? And what do you feel the kind of knock-on impact could be from that?
Well, I think, I mean, what I hope is, so last night we had, you can see this poster behind me, this is the cover of the magazine. Last night we had a launch party for the magazine, and many of the writers, many of the sponsors, and many of the subjects of our stories showed up, and they all signed the poster, and we had some really great conversations. And, you know, one of the stories I heard last night, a woman was describing, you know, her children, some of whom are darker, some of whom are lighter. And she had been describing one of her sons having this experience of not feeling like he fit in with the rest of the people in the, you know, around here or in the state's culture. And I hope that the magazine provides a sense for everybody who might not realize how deep and rich the diversity in the state is, that they're not alone here, and that they're welcome here. That's a, you know, I think a big opportunity, and one that, again, we heard about from the people that we looked to for advice, was that it's not just a question of making the state seem attractive or for people to move here from diverse communities elsewhere. But also, once people arrive, continuing to reinforce that sense of belonging. And I think without representation in media, it's very difficult for people to have that sense.
Absolutely. And you mentioned the event last night, and McLean hosts a lot of events throughout the year. Do you plan to host events to support and showcase the stories in the publication?
I don't know yet. We do plan to continue our launch party series with each issue. And I think that's, you know, that on a small scale, you know, it's not like a big public event, but on a small scale, it's such a great opportunity to hear from everybody who contributed to the work and what their ideas are for refining it and moving it forward so it continues to evolve. But I would love to do a larger scale event. But I'd also be, I think another opportunity would be for us to look at some of the great events that are happening in the state right now and partner with those or find ways to support those. We don't have to be at the center of everything.
That's great. And lastly, how can people find it?
Right now, people can order it off the website, which is 603diversity.com. They can pop into the Manchester Chamber of Commerce, the Nashua Chamber of Commerce, the Portsmouth Chamber Collaborative, or the Concord Chamber of Commerce, and they all have copies. Not to be self-serving, but they could subscribe to New Hampshire Magazine or New Hampshire Business Review, and they would get their very own copy in the mail. Now, and of course, it is also available as a digital edition at 603diversity.com.
Perfect. Well, Ernesto Burden, publisher of McLean Communications, thanks for joining us to discuss the release of 603 Diversity. Best of luck with this new publication.
Thank you so much, Melanie.
We turn now to freelance writer, columnist, and podcast host Anthony Payton, whose Common Ground initiative aims to highlight the diversity of New Hampshire communities with stories of people the average Granite Stater might not get to see or meet. The goal is to clarify misconceptions and find the threads that bind us all together as one New Hampshire community. Welcome, Anthony, and thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me. Hi, Melanie.
Hi.
Thank you.
So first, tell us a little bit about yourself and your background.
Well, I'm from Brooklyn, New York. I made my way up to New England in maybe around 2002, 2003. And I saw things that I didn't really get to see in my neighborhoods back in Brooklyn. Although New York and Brooklyn is very diverse, you only get to see one side of certain populations in certain areas in some regards. Mm-hmm. So I was exposed to a lot of different things. My parents both brought me up to, you know, judge people on how they treat you, mm-hmm. and, you know, try not to make any preconceived thoughts, or don't be so quick to make an assessment about people mm-hmm. until you get to know them. And so I always tried to stay with that, Sometimes I think we all tend to slip away from it. Sure. And we buy into narratives that, you know, kind of go against the grain, so to speak. So, and I love writing as well. So that's one of my things that I can say, definitely.
So let's talk a little bit more about that. How did you start writing?
Well, when I was younger, my mom and dad, they always stressed education. I can remember when my mother, years ago, I would go to her and say, "Mom, I'm hungry." And she would say, "Okay, go find a better word for hungry and come back." And then I would say, "Mom, I'm famished." And she would say, "Okay." You know, and the same with my dad. I remember counting his paycheck. He would give me his paycheck and I would count it. And he said, "Well, you know, that's the idea of money. You send these out to bring more back." So that was his rough course on investing. And that was that carried on with me into life. So ever since then, I loved writing all through grade school and even in college. So, and it's kind of therapeutic for me as well.
Sure. And you talk a lot about your family in the Common Ground Initiative, the work that's part of that. So can you talk to us a little bit about, explain what the Common Ground Initiative is?
Well, I think it hits the nail on the head when we say it's to, we want to highlight the diversity that is in New Hampshire, but at the same time, we want to bridge the gaps between certain communities. The inner city community, so to speak, and, you know, the white guys who might be in the woods who drive the 4x4 pickups. Throughout my travels throughout New England, I happen to spend plenty of time with guys like that. And they have their own views, and I had my own views, but we were able to express those views, and we did it in a civil manner, and we got to see the other side of the coin, whereas too many people don't see that side of the coin. So one of the episodes that triggered it was me going to a Walmart in Hooksett. And I spoke about it in the first podcast. And I saw a guy and I made my assessment of him right away. And everything that I had in my head about him turned out to be like the complete opposite. And I wound up striking a good conversation with the guy. And then later on in the parking lot, he wound up having not a 4x4 truck that I imagined that he would. Or that he did, but, you know, he had a regular sedan, and there was a black woman that was outside of the sedan that was helping him with bags, and I think that was a significant other. So that kind of threw me for a loop.
Sure. So, and you were talking a little bit about, you know, being able already, you know, in your own experience to have these relationships that on the surface, you know, people might think were a little, you know, odd because you might be coming from such different backgrounds or ideologies. So why do you think you were able to do that? Like, why were you and the folks that you've become friends with in that group that you're talking about, like, how were you able to do that, do you think? What was the important ingredient? What had to be there for you to be able to make that connection and that relationship?
Great question. I think it was my open-mindedness and open-heartedness. And it goes back to my parents again. Like, I've been through a lot in my life, and, you know, I didn't take the right roads in certain situations, but a lot of things that they taught stuck with me. Mm-hmm. And, you know, even, you know, I remember my mother and father, like, you know, people didn't have a place to sleep, they would bring them in. And so I kind of carry that in my heart. And I'm open-minded, and I have the perspective of people who are living in the inner city communities who may not be as open-minded to talking with the guys who are out in the woods. And it's like sometimes I feel like I'm that conduit. I'm that bridge, you know, to guys in my community who used to believe that, you know, all white people lived above average. Mm-hmm. And going to New England, it was my first time experiencing certain levels of white poverty. Mm-hmm. And that really threw me back because when I experienced it, the only differences that I really saw was the absence of gun violence. Yeah. Whereas every other element seemed to be there. There was like fatherless homes, poor nutrition, and things along those lines. So, you know, I became sympathetic to it, so to speak.
Yeah. So why do you think it was important for you, and why do you think it's important generally for something like this project to happen right now, to exist right now?
Well, I believe as a nation, I believe this not only is a state and a nation, we're in like a pivotal period. There are so many people who are upset with how the country's being run, regardless to who's running it. And it seems like they turn their angst toward sometimes people who look like me, mm-hmm. and immigrants and things along those lines. And it's like, I just want to express that we're not the enemy. There's a commonality, whereas we all want safer neighborhoods. We all want better schools for our kids. So we want to, you know, to be able to live a good life. And I think those are the common denominators that bind us. And we have to stop thinking that we're in each other's way. Because mm-hmm. I believe that ultimately is, you know, a self-sabotage, and it's for us to grow not only as a state, but as a nation.
Absolutely. And what were some of your concerns when you started the project?
Well, one of the first ones would be that sometimes I play devil's advocate, and I didn't want people from my community mm-hmm. to feel like I was, not to say sellout, but like, well, hey, you've been in New Hampshire too long, you know? And then I was worried about, you know, white people or good-hearted white people, you know, to later use my words to weaponize my words, so to speak. And, you know, well, look what Anthony said. He said this, and this is what I've been saying this whole time. So I just didn't want to become like, you know, one of those black pundits who, like, you know, political pundits who are, you know, constantly bashing the black community. I didn't want to be viewed as that, nor did I want to be viewed as an extremist on the other side. So those were a few of my fears.
Sure. And how has it been received so far? What kind of responses have you gotten to it?
Overall, it's been like mind blowing. People from Tilton, Laconia, different parts of the state have been just encouraging to continue doing what I'm doing and telling those stories and giving my perspective. So I look forward for that to continue.
And who are some of the people that we're going to meet through your project going forward?
Well, we've already met a black veteran. We're going to be meeting my co-parent, Shantae, who's just, you know, she's a mother, business owner, community activist. You know, she and her family are embedded well into this community. There's also a hairdresser where I want to address black hair. Mm-hmm. And that's not really, you know, spoken about. It's a sensitive topic. And I guess I'm going to be the guy to air, I don't want to say dirty laundry, but like things that go on in the black community that people aren't really privy to. Mm-hmm. And just to, you know, open that door up, because I believe that it shouldn't just be a conversation that's just held within us. And everyone should get to know our sensitivities and things like that. Then there's a college professor who I believe we're trying to get him next, who is trying to put college into the prisons. And he's trying to help college into the prisons and also help people who are getting out with college to continue their education. Because I believe education is very big for a person who needs to recalibrate and come back to society. So, you know, get gainful employment and things along those lines. So those are just a few. And there's so many great people that I met last night. I don't know how I'm going to do this interview. It might have to be like a mass interview. There were so many great people. So
that's great. And so where can people read your work, including your columns, and hear the podcast?
Well, you can read the column on collaborativenh.org/Common Ground Initiative. You can also catch us on Podbean under Common Ground Initiative. Just in case, you know, there's a lot of people who may not have the time to read, but you can definitely put your earphones in and listen to exactly what's being written.
That's great. Freelance writer, columnist, and podcast host Anthony Payton, thank you so much for joining us today.
Thank you for having me.
The conversation continues online. We want to hear from you. What is your diversity story? Visit our Facebook page at collaborativenh.org and use the hashtag 603diversity to let us know. Thank you for watching. We'll see you next time on The State We're In.